Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Talk with Sorinthan Haorei. Today we are joined by Honourable Member of Parliament of the Outer Parliamentary Constituency, Dr Lorho S Pfoze, for a very exclusive interview. I'm sure this is going to be a very fruitful interaction. Welcome to the show, sir, and thank you for agreeing to do this with us. It is an honour to host you today. So just before we talk about the main issues, we'd like to get it started lightly. So people know you as the MP, as an MP, and not many people know you about your background, about your family. So we want to get to know a little bit more about your background and also about your family. Can you kindly share some with us briefly? Yeah.
Sorin, thank you so much for taking me on your Indigenous Hills Network. It's a privilege. I've heard much about you and your network, and today being the first time, I just want to say thank you. Well, about my family life, I'm from Mao, that is the so-called Mao Gate. I have married a Tangkhul girl from Somdo,
right.
And I have three children, two boys and a girl. All of them are married. Today I have six grandchildren.
Okay.
Yeah. By God's grace, I'm a medical doctor, and I started work with the sick people. Mm-hmm. Or rather for the health of the community in general. Mm-hmm. So I was for some time also posted in, besides around here in Imphal Valley, mm-hmm. I was also posted in Chingai in Okrul district,
okay.
Then also in the hills at Sanapati. So I've had a very brief experience of life both in the valley and off the hills. And during my experience as a government servant, I realized that there were a lot of shortfalls, particularly in the services provided in the hill areas, mm-hmm. for which I decided that maybe this may not be the right thing for me to continue on. Mm-hmm. And so later on, I resigned from government job. I went for my further studies. Then I came back and started a small private clinic. But by and by, I realized that community service is where I'm called. And so I started mm-hmm. with community service. So that is how I end up here. In the process, okay. I did a little bit of entrepreneurship. Mm-hmm. I went into manufacturing and then also into various other activities. I was working with the NGOs, mm-hmm. working mainly on livelihood of the people.
Okay.
And then how to, you know, build community organizations. Mm-hmm. You know, building up community was a very important thing,
right.
Capacity building. And so that was where I involved. In the process of my community health service, I was involved in training of, you know, women. Mm-hmm. Women, especially married women, so mm-hmm. that we trained them as community health workers. So we trained selecting women from all sections of the people. You know, during those time, the Kuki-Naga conflict mm-hmm. was still fresh, and people were very hesitant to go to each other, meet each other. Confidence and, you know, there was always that fear factor amongst the people.
Right.
And it was during that time that we motivated girls from the Kuki community, mm-hmm. girls from the various Naga communities also, to come together and be trained at a particular place. Right. And during the practical services, we took them to Kuki areas, all of them together. Mm-hmm. We took them to Naga areas, all of them together. Hesitation was there in the beginning. Mm-hmm. But I think that is how the ice was broken. We went into the communities and we were very well received. The services were very good and people were trained and confidence building was brought like that.
Okay.
And so that motivated me to go into uh-huh. political life.
Right,
so
right,
slowly,
right. Okay.
By and by.
Right. We're glad to know that you have a very beautiful family, as well as thank you for letting us know your inspiring and your challenging life. Thank you for letting us know who Dr. Lorho, the real person, is not just a politician. And yes, before you joined the politics, this political line, not many people know about your journey. So we're very inspired, and the challenges you have taken up is so inspiring. Yeah. Serving and helping the people has been one of your passion,
right.
And your commitment. Yes, so being an MP, and this is your first time you have become an MP, the first tenure. So we would like to know how your experience has been so far, and whether it's the reality is different from your expectation, if there's any challenges, where you're able to do what you wish to do. We would like to know your experiences so far.
Yeah, coming into politics is a very interesting arena. It's new to me. I was never in politics. However, my passion for social service motivated me to go into politics. Mm-hmm. When I went into politics, my expectation, my vision was very big. I really thought that we will be able to achieve so many things. But when you actually get into the field, mm-hmm. it is not as you think. It is okay. a big, big challenge. There are a lot of hurdles that we have to overcome. Mm. There are a lot of challenges that we have to meet. And it is not easy. India right. being a great, great country, and we, those of us from Northeast, and particularly from the hills of Manipur, mm. we are such a small people. And so when we go in out there, many times we tend to get lost. Mm-hmm. And then new as a politician, my first year's experience was rather more of learning. I had so much to learn. I had so much to explore. And while I was learning and beginning to know a little bit, mm-hmm. then the pandemic came and 2 years of total shutdown became a big, big problem. Right. That really hurt my expectations. And then I really thought that we are going for six. So, okay. So anyway, the corona, it was also a challenging time. Mm-hmm. But during that time also, we thought we may not be able to do much. But however, we tried to reach out to the people mm-hmm. to assuage the fears and apprehensions of the people. Right. And then there were a lot of issues, particularly with our trade, commerce, and mm-hmm. Livelihood. And so we had to motivate our own people not to be afraid of, but yet being very careful with following all the SOPs. And so when that was done, we went motivated people to give from their, whatever is grown in their gardens, particularly those in the hills. We have all our vegetables and those things that are grown in the jungles. So to collect those and then take it down to the valley, because the valley people, they were really suffering also at that point of time. And so they brought their thing. We went around in the villages distributing them. And that was a very, very good thing. It was well received by the valley people also. And in the process, the valley people also, they shared some of the, little things like dal and rice and salt or something right. like that, which they have. Mm-hmm. But whereas these green, fresh vegetables were something that they had really long, they could not get for a long time. Mm-hmm. And so like that, we went into many of the areas. So that was one challenge. Mm-hmm. And so by and by, yeah, now the after the pandemic is over, mm-hmm. during the last year and this year, the government also is opening up its services. And we are beginning to be able to move around and then try to see if we can actually implement some of the aspirations or desires of the people.
Okay, thank you. And yes, it must have been a very challenging tenure for you. Would like to know if, out of this, you told us that once you step out of our comfort zone, we tend to be lost. And then it's something new for you. We'd like to know how the MPs or other parliamentarian out of this Northeast, we used to say mainland India,
yeah.
how do they perceive us, especially to the tribals? How do these politicians take us for?
See, very essentially, I belong to the Naga People's Front.
Right.
And the Naga People's Front was not a very welcome party,
okay.
both in Manipur and also maybe even outside.
All right.
And so, yeah, there had to be a time for us to make adjustments, to make people understand who we are, what we stand for. Mm-hmm. And because of the misunderstanding of the people on the very political party that I represent, during the election time, I got almost very little vote from the non-Naga areas.
All right.
But during this outreach that we gave, I think one of my priority was to build bridges amongst the mm-hmm. gaps that are already existing between the various communities. Misunderstandings, we try to, clarify and then, let them know who we are
right.
and what we stand for. Mm-hmm. And in the process, I think there was one of the biggest achievement mm-hmm. is being able to build bridges.
Okay.
Today, I feel very free with mm-hmm. various other Naga communities, okay. particularly even amongst tribals. Mm-hmm. They are accepting me. I go there, they invite me, they come to my place, and we feel very free and comfortable. Okay. Even amongst the Métis, they thought that the Naga party was there out to break the integrity of Manipur. Mm. But I would like to say that we are here just for this, to help our people to understand and also to build up that we will grow as a community, that will be a people that will live together peacefully. And so I think slowly people began to understand that NPF is after all not to divide Manipur. Right. And so I think today the NPF is being accepted. We have joined the government here in Manipur also, and then the government, we are given place, we are accepted, and our ministers, our MLAs are doing very well. Okay. Well, when we say doing very well, you know, those of you who elected us may have some reservations. You may say you're not totally satisfied. Yes, we cannot satisfy each and everybody, but to a great extent, I think we have been accepted by various communities and the party has done pretty well. And so we only hope that our minds will be, our minds as well also should be more and more open, and that we will also be accepted by others more and more, so that we merge together and you know, live together peacefully.
Right. Thank you. We're glad to know that you have been bridging the gaps, and despite our differences, we're able to work together. We're glad to know that. Talking about achievements, during this, since your election 2019 till now, we would like to know if there are any major works completed under your leadership, under your vision, or under your supervision. We'd like to know that, and then if there's any major issues which you have raised in the parliament in the interest of the public, we'd like to know that.
Well, the desires of the people, the vision that I have for our people are many.
Right.
But you know, it is not very easy to translate them into you know, perceivable things. And so basically the one of the first most important thing that I have wanted to do was to raise to the central government the need to bring the regional aspirations in the heart of the national national ambition that they have. India wants to be a strong country, but when trying to build a strong country, if the regional people are being left out, their aspirations are not being addressed, you know, that becomes one of the main issue. And so the rift will always continue to be there from the inside. So this is one thing that I've tried to address. And in my, because I am a single man party, and so I represent, even in the core committees of the parliamentary boards, we have the all party floor leaders meeting, where in with the leaders of the government, the Prime Minister, the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha leaders, and also with the various other important leaders of the government, we sit together with various other political parties to address this type of issues. So there also I've raised multiple times, and then many of our parties, they also begin to understand us, they appreciate the views that we share. Then again at the NDA meeting, that is the National Democratic Alliance, we are about 16 political parties that used to be supporting the government. Today we are reduced to 14. And so even in that, that is a closer meeting with the those that are involved in the formation of the government, the NDA. And so the Prime Minister almost always chairs the meeting. The Home Minister is there, the Defense Minister, who is the leader of the Lok Sabha, and also leader of the Rajya Sabha, also always is there with the national president of the BJP as well. So while we shared those type of things there, I do share about the need to address the Indo-Naga peace talks, the various other peace talks that have been initiated with the underground groups, particularly in Manipur, even the Sioux, this also I have also mentioned, and that we have always addressed that a comprehensive you know, solution should be brought. Solution should not be piecemeal, solution should be concrete, and it should satisfy each aspiration. And so that being so, and then we have also told them to extend invitation to the other underground groups who are not in the peace talk with the government right now. And so if these things are being brought, we will only hope that the desire of the regional aspirations will be met, and this will bring a more cohesive, strong India. And that is what I've always been talking about. And so this is being appreciated. Mm-hmm. So this is one. Then we have also the various issues, development deficit issues, particularly on our road infrastructure. Mm-hmm. And so with the coming of this new government, they have initiated, they have rather coined from look east to act east.
Right.
And so I've always mentioned, sir, you have always said that there, it should be act east, but what are the tangible, visible things that are coming?
Right.
And so now because of which, I will not say it is because of me, but it is the, you know, the desire of the government that road infrastructures are being built.
Mm-hmm.
And so even within Manipur, we have insisted that the existing national highways be improved and the work, whichever is being taken, should be taken up in a very quick pace. And I think I'm glad that to some extent it is being followed.
Mm-hmm.
There are a number of new national highways which have been identified and it has been declared by the government of India mm-hmm. for Manipur. And some of those projects will be, I think maybe within this year, we hope that some things will come out and works will also be started. We have also demanded for, you know, a good road mm-hmm. on of national highway stature.
Okay.
May not be four lane, but maybe a two lane along the international border
mm-hmm.
between Indo-Myanmar border.
Okay.
And so this right from Moray or even south from Churchampur side, it all along the parallel to the international border, a road is being proposed and we are pursuing it very vigorously.
Okay.
And we're only hoping that the government will start work.
Mm-hmm.
And so that is one. Then the other thing is also the on the network networking system, the railways,
mm-hmm.
the Silchar, that Tupul area through Jiribam.
Yeah.
This road is getting over. It will be
okay.
reaching Imphal Valley within, hopefully within this December. That is what they have said, 23
okay.
December.
Mm.
But even if it takes a little longer time, I don't know. But it will come. It is coming anyway.
Okay.
Now, new railway systems from Imphal to Moray.
Mm-hmm.
That will connect with Southeast Asia.
Right.
That will become one of those corridors for the Asian Highway.
Mm-hmm.
That is also the, I think the surveys have been more or less complete.
Okay.
And then a new railway from Imphal to connecting with Zubza in Nagaland. That is passing through Senapati and then Mao, Kohima and Zubza.
Okay.
So that also is being proposed and the survey, I think it will be over by this
okay.
March.
Okay. Sorry to interrupt, but are all this a part of the Act East policy or is it a different?
The Act East policy, yes, of course, the emphasis that the government has been giving in developing Northeast.
Okay.
Because unless Northeast is developed,
right.
India will not be developed. That is the Prime Minister's vision.
Okay.
And so the Prime Minister's vision is part of the Prime Minister's vision.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, definitely it is part of that Act East.
Okay.
Because with Act East, it has to connect to Southeast Asian countries to improve trade, border, trade and commerce, and also relationship and
okay.
various other tourism and other aspects.
So in your opinion, is the government true to the, policy, Act East policy, are they going to keep it as it is? Or because we have been hearing this for a very, very long time. It was earlier Look East policy, Act East policy, it's been changed now. So looking at the development pace which have been taken, it's taking so long. So do you think the government will be true to this policy? Will they be able to keep their promises?
Yes, it is not, the speed is not as expected by the people.
Right.
Yeah, it's seemingly a little slow. Basically, it's because of the pandemic.
All right.
It has slowed down to a great extent.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm convinced that the government is committed.
Okay.
The government is, unless we are connected with Southeast Asia, our trade, our commerce, our development will not be complete.
Okay.
And so that is where, and then India, by the grace of God, is improving in its international stature.
Mm-hmm.
It is becoming a world economy,
right.
great economy.
Okay.
And so maybe third or fourth. So I think that is a good thing. And so in the process of that, we are moving out to develop, to bring in a lot more industries, even to India,
mm-hmm.
to Northeast India, particularly in Manipur also.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of trade routes are being opened. And recently, you are aware the G20 also was held. And in this, it is a lot of motivating factor for the rest of the world also to come and see no Manipur, and then they see the opportunities that Manipur can also offer.
Okay.
So this is part of the G20, I mean, activist. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Getting lots of information right now, and thankful for that. And for India to become a superpower, or so to say, for the ACIS policy to be implemented successfully, I believe it is very important to solve the Indo-Naga political talk, this issue. And one of the longest, I think, peace process which have been going on, and then the people, the Naga people, the public, we are frustrated. We have been waiting for so long, and then we have been waiting for this honorable and peaceful solution, which is acceptable for all. But it seems that there's an opinion going on which says India has been betraying the interests of the Nagas. India has been not keeping their promises. India is not really interested with the interests of the Nagas. So what really is your opinion on the ongoing Indo-Naga peace process? And also, if there's anything which can be changed according to your suggestion, if you opine anything, which, because sometimes we feel that it has been going on the same as it is, the same old convention, apart from the peace accord, nothing has been not been done. That is the opinion of the public as of now. So do you think there is a possibility, or if there's any outcome which can be brought forward as soon as possible, how would what is your opinion on this particular issue?
See, on the India Indo-Naga peace process, I think the Naga issue is a very complicated issue, both for the government of India and also even for the Nagas. I also shared the opinion of the raised by the people also. I also shared that view that it has been going on for too long a time.
Right.
You know, since the signing of the peace accord in 1997 till now, it is more than 25 years. And then later on in 2015, when the framework agreement was signed, there was a lot of hopes that were being raised.
Mm-hmm.
And earlier to that, of course, when the national leaders of the Naga people, when they were talking with the government from outside of the country, when they came to India, we saw that hope was being really raised, and we thought that solution was very near.
Mm-hmm.
However, because of the complexities that are involved with the issues, I think it has taken more and more time than necessary.
Okay.
During which time, the Nagas have also seemingly changed our own perception towards this, and then a lot of divisions coming up.
Right.
And so which has actually slowed down the whole process. I only wish that Nagas remain as one, mm-hmm. that we are committed, we are, our aspiration, we are not split on our minds. And if Nagas are one, I'm sure the government of India will be very willing to trash out if there are any more differences with the government, to trash it out with the people. It will take time, mm-hmm. but it can be achieved. It is something that is achievable. Yeah, coming to when you are talking about the Indo-Naga peace process, the sticking points are the flag and the constitution.
Right.
The government is trying to propose some things that may be acceptable.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we are yet to understand from the other side how it is being accepted, but there are still sticking issues that are there. I think if the two groups sincerely meet together, there will be areas where we can actually trash it out and come to a solution. That is what I feel. I think it is needful for the government of India also to be a little more sincere,
right.
a little more senior leaders of the government to be involved, rather than just using bureaucrats
right.
and retired personnels to come into this. Senior leadership involved in trashing out, because now the competencies as the peace process, during the peace process, we have seen, we have heard that the interlocutors say that the issues have been settled.
Mm-hmm.
Competencies may have been formed, and agreement to those type of competencies could have come.
Mm-hmm.
But the sticking points are the actual political issues. So political issues should be dealt with by the political leaders, not by bureaucrats. That is my take. Mm-hmm. And so I have also mentioned this on these issues during our meetings with the top leaders.
Okay.
They are not very, what do you call, they don't share their opinion out aloud immediately.
All right.
But I hope that what we have shared has sunk into their mind, into their hearts. Mm-hmm. We only hope that the government of India will be able to come to its reasoning and then proper reasoning and then trash it out with our leaders. And I think our leaders are also ready to meet with the top leaderships, but somehow there seems to be a gap where things are not happening.
Right. We all hope for an honorable and an acceptable solution for all as soon as possible.
Yeah.
In any instances or incidences, have you ever talked to any government representatives or even the top leaders, the top parliamentarians regarding this issue?
Yes, as I've mentioned, I've spoken to the Honorable Prime Minister.
Okay.
I've spoken to the Honorable Home Minister as well. And even the Defense Minister, who was then the Home Minister, I've spoken also to him. I've spoken to the BJP leadership also, spoken to various other political leaderships of various other political parties also. They also shared the same thing. The only thing is that Nagas cannot be an independent country. They must come within the constitution.
It's they've been sticking to that point.
They always keep on sticking to that. Right. But, see, Nagas have, to a great extent, you know, been accommodative.
Okay.
The leadership, as they have also always mentioned, Nagas have been always accommodative. And so we only think that whatever sticking points are there, if the top leaderships will meet, I'm sure it can be resolved.
Right.
That is my hope.
Right.
And so that is it.
Right.
Earlier,
you mentioned about India not being sincere enough. Earlier, it used to be the first three conditions which were laid down were the talks to be at the prime minister level, has to be in the third country, and then the talks will be unconditional. But then it has gone down to the level of bureaucrats taking up this process. So do you think the government is really committed or sincere enough? Because like we have discussed earlier, the public has very been frustrated. And also not just the Indian government. What about us Nagas? Are we doing enough? Are we committed enough? Are we making it a mass movement? Do we really want this solution? Or are we just focused on our own interests and then more so to be honest, we are more interested in the Indian electoral politics. That's what the public's opinion is. How do we balance this? And then what about the public? Are we doing enough for us Nagas?
Yeah, I think it is for the public to judge for themselves. But as we say, in 1997, when the ceasefire was
agreement,
first signed, I think there was a lot of sincerity.
Mm-hmm.
We thought that to be in a third country at the highest level and also unconditional, I think this was one of the biggest move, the commitment that the government of India has also given. And the fact that they went around tracing the Naga leaders from across the globe and then trying to establish contact with them, I think these were some of the sincere efforts that the government has given. Now, when we look at the present day status, since 1997 till today, the Nagas have been hoping that once the talk starts, it will come to a conclusion, a positive conclusion. This has not been coming forth. And that is why, as you have also mentioned earlier, that the frustration of the people, the loss of confidence, the delay has caused so much of unpleasant effects, even amongst the Naga population also, amongst the underground groups also, a lot of factions.
Right.
Yeah, these are also there. Then coming again on the political aspects, the Indian election that our people are also involved in. You know, our people are involved in the Indian election particularly because of the need to survive.
Right.
And so this survival is one of the important things. If everyone takes up their guns and then go after them, the development will not come.
Right.
How do we earn to feed ourselves? These are some of the necessary things. However, in the background of all those things, I think that people are still committed. When we go into the general public, mm-hmm. discuss with them that they want Naga solution.
Right.
Yeah, even those who are in the election, they also mm-hmm. want Naga solution.
Right.
Those who are maybe, let us say, those who may be themselves employed with the Indian Army, they mm-hmm. are also wanting a solution.
Right.
See, the basic thing is our land, to where we are so much attached, needs peace, mm-hmm. needs to develop, needs to be conducive for creation of a good relationship with our neighbors. We want to live in good relationship with our neighbors everywhere around, be it in Manipur, be it in Assam, right. Nagaland, or Arunachal, mm-hmm. and even in Myanmar. Now, so all those things are there, but sometimes the world scenario in mm-hmm. politics, mm-hmm. geopolitics also changes, and
right.
so this also impacts upon the Nagas. The one of the main things that you have issued is the Nagas should unite.
Mm-hmm.
The Nagas should come back together on a platform whereby we shed all our differences, we forget the past mistakes, the past hurts, those wounds should be mended, and then we come together. Then only the government of India will be able to say, yes, now's
right.
the time. So I think we have yet a lot
right.
more to go.
Right. Mm-hmm. So we Nagas have much to do as well.
Much
we
to
cannot
do
always pinpoint and depend on the Indian government alone.
Exactly.
Yeah, we
so.
Have to come together as one, make it a mass movement, and I think that would be a big step forward. Yes, thank you so much for sharing your opinion on that. Yes, well, talking about the Indian electoral politics, let's come to the delimitation issue. I think this is one of the most contentious issues, and then especially for the tribal people of Manipur. We feel that, and yes, it is also a fact that we are undemocratically represented in the Manipur Legislative Assembly election, and we have the information that the delimitation is to be conducted in 2026. That is what the information is. And then the public has the opinion that there might be some elements which may disturb this process one more time. Does it include the Manipur government as well? We never know, because the trend has been the delimitation process has been delayed again and again. So what is your opinion on this? And then what are the hindrances, the stumbling blocks that has been blocking us to exercise the delimitation, which is a rightful act? And then if there is any solution or suggestion on your opinion, we'd like to hear it from you.
Yeah, the delimitation in Manipur happened way back in the 70s,
right.
mid-70s. And then following that, the new delimitation law, I should say, act was passed in 2022. Following that, the delimitation exercise started in almost the whole nation.
Mm-hmm.
But in the process, the delimitation happened elsewhere. But in Manipur, it was set aside.
Right.
So 2008, when the actual delimitation happened elsewhere, it did not happen. So that was one of the biggest pain that came to the tribals of Manipur, to the hills. We have always felt that we are underrepresented.
Mm.
We are not, our representation should have been a little more, you know, based not only on population, but also on the geography,
right.
the size of the you know, the constituencies. See, if we look at the Manipur today, the 20 hill assembly constituencies in the hills of Manipur, each is covering over a little over 1,000 square kilometers,
mm-hmm.
where the 40 constituencies in the valley, it's 50 square kilometers. So we think that, you know, and then when we look at that, that may be as it may be because of the population, but when you look at the development needs,
mm-hmm.
the MLAs or whoever represents these people, they get their local area development fund very limited, same, equal for
right.
everyone.
Right.
So whether it is 50 square kilometers or 1,000 square kilometers, they're just getting the same amount.
Mm-hmm.
And so definitely, whatever, when the geography is big, it cannot reach. Therefore, there is also a demand from amongst the tribal communities that the geography should be taken into account.
Mm-hmm.
We may not share equally the same size, but from existing, say, in Kamjong, for example, existing more than 2,400 square kilometers right. for just one single constituency. Mm-hmm. It can be slightly reduced, or whether the government is rather thinking of increasing the area development funds. Not only the MLA LAT or MP LAT, but it should also affect into the share of the development from the various departments. Mm-hmm. So if those are increased, I think if equitable share is given, then I think there may be a sense of satisfaction. Mm-hmm. But today we see that there is a lot of differences. The mm-hmm. discrepancies are too many, too much, right, right. and it is very difficult. And so this is there. Now, delimitation in recent times, there has been demand from various other states. Mm-hmm. Recently, even in Arunachal, they are going on rallies and things like that, which may be good, may not be good, I don't know. But then that creates a pressure on the government, of the concerned government. Mm-hmm. And so it is the government who have to put up the proposal. Whereas in Manipur, there seem to be no demand from our communities. Mm-hmm. And the government of India is sitting on, government of Manipur is sitting on it because they think that when delimitation is done, there are some issues that may raise up some law and order issues mm-hmm. or some things like that. So I think this is something that it is very intricate, and mm-hmm. I don't like to dwell into it very detailedly, mm-hmm. but it is up to the people that okay. if they want it, they right. should raise their voices. Right. Otherwise, I have raised these voices in the parliament, and also we went to this, you know, mm-hmm. going to the streets, attending one dharna in mm-hmm. Jantar Mantar in Delhi. Mm-hmm. It was not perceived well by the government, by my coalition partners. Mm-hmm. They didn't think it too good. So anyway, because we have limitations in our own way, but I said that these are the demands of my people. I have to raise the demands of my people. Mm-hmm. So that is one. And this delimitation now I'll club together with the district councils,
yeah.
ADCs also. Yeah. The ADCs, the councillors mm-hmm. or the ex-councillors, they came and visited Delhi.
Right.
They met me and requested me to take them here, there. I did what I could, mm-hmm. took them, raised the issues with the concerned authorities. However, this being a state issue, it has to come back to the state again.
Okay.
And so the state has to make recommendations to the center. And so who will make these recommendations? Are the people in the state raising enough voices so mm-hmm. that it is heard by the state government and then it is referred, or are we just keeping quiet? Mm-hmm. So these are some things that we need to understand. We tribals, we are very passive in mm-hmm. our approach. We just come, take it as it comes. Mm-hmm. So we are not maybe too proactive and trying to be visionaries and then try to fight ahead of time. So unless things are done in its proper perspective, things may be neglected. Mm-hmm. This is one of my fear. 2026, yes, they say that general delimitation will come again. So these are things that we need to see. Mm-hmm. Then when 26 comes, mm. whether the same type of issues will come,
right.
same type of things that will come and then will be beaten down. Mm-hmm. We have to be very careful.
Right.
So our people okay. have to be alert.
Right. Thank you so much. Listening to your opinion, I feel that it is us public who are not doing enough. I think if we really want it, I think we need to do what needs to be done. And especially the civil society organizations, I think they should be in the forefront to lead this issue and then people to back it up. Do you think the same? Or what do you suggest the CSOs and the public should be doing to get? I think this, regarding the ADC, I think the election has not been conducted for so many years and so many developmental activities has been on hold, and then this is a constitutional right. The constitution has been has empowered us, this ADC, but the Manipur government seems to be giving fake promises, like the election will be conducted in October, by February, and now in April, but it's not been conducted at all. What do you think the people and the CSO should be doing at the moment?
See, I do not want to be seen as a person who is instigating the CSOs. Mm-hmm. But then it is up to the people.
Okay.
You know, unless it is a people's movement, We in India, it's a democracy.
Right.
The democracy is for the people, by the people, and of the people. So for the people, yes, we are being elected for the people, but by the people and of the people, if they do not work on that two aspects, it becomes very difficult to say that I'm for them. They do not feel it, they do not know it, but I know it, and I cannot talk ahead of time.
No? Right, right.
So I think it is for the people to actually move.
Okay. Okay.
CSOs represent the people, so it's up
right,
to them.
Right, right. Yes. Thank you so much for reminding us, and you know, and I'm sure this is gonna help the CSOs and the public realize that there's so much thing to do. We should stop depending so much on our politicians and act up. Yes, talking about the discrepancies in the hills and valleys, and especially in terms of development. Now let's come to the ST demand of the Métis community. They have been working relentlessly to get the ST status. We'd like to know the consequence, the impact, if by any chance, if they get the ST status, how is it going to affect the tribals, especially of the Manipur, the people of the Manipur, and then how do we protect ourselves? Because we, I think, as tribals, we are unique people with different tradition, different custom, indigenous people. But then when people, when community like the Métis get the ST status, does it gonna have negative impact on us? And if there's any ways, preventive measures, or how do we protect ourselves, we'd like to know your opinion on this.
See, our friends, our neighbors, the Métis, are a very developed society. We know that their history, they claim also that it is for more than 2,000 years. And so, and then again, if we look at the development of the Métis people, I think in every sphere, education, technologies, doctors, nurses, and engineers, and you know, every other technology, they are very, very well advanced, well ahead of all of us. Now that when we compare it to the tribals, I think we are hardly 120 years old in our civilization. You know, the first people who learned, in fact, we also know very well that our first educated people were sometime, they were educated sometime 1920s. So those are the people that are there. And so by that time, the Métis were already very developed. And so I really do not know. Till that time, the Nagas were head hunting, and then we were primitive. Our culture, our dress, our food habits, everything were so primitive. And we cannot, actually there is no comparison between these two classes of people. But however, when the Métis are demanding that they also need to be given this ST status, it is their desire, and we cannot suppress them. They have every right to demand.
Okay.
It is only up to the authority, the government of India, to decide whether or not this is rightful. You know, sometimes I only used to think that, yes, Métis may want ST status for various reasons they know, for reservation, for land, for this, for that, you know, as we can, as tribals are apprehensive of. They have got various reasons for which they want. The only thing is, the rights that the tribals have today, whether they will be overstepped, whether we will still be, you know, crumbled in the melee, you know. So these are some issues that needs to be understood and then analyzed by the government of India, and it is up to them to decide. Now, if the Nagas, if the tribals say okay, no matter what, it is up to them, up to our people. But I think, as you have mentioned, the tribals are very apprehensive, and then these apprehensions do not come from nowhere. They are basis. There are reasons why they should be apprehensive.
Right.
And so I think it is good for us to understand each other. I do not like to say that Métis should not demand. They may demand. I do not say that the tribals should go against their demand. I think everybody has their own right, but there has to be those people who are there to implement should understand and analyze and see the logic behind. So a 2,000 years old civilization with maybe 100 or so years civilization, I do not know how it can come on the same platform.
Right.
So
right.
that is just my view, personal view. I'm not against, but yeah, that is my personal view.
Okay, thank you. Do you think we tribals are doing enough to, you know, understand the situation and then the threat we have been, you know, with the situation happening? For example, like you have mentioned, 2,000-year-old civilization with the same status as us, do you think we'll be able to protect ourselves and are doing enough for this?
See, Maitis, as they are an old civilization, the advantage that they have is the language is spoken by everybody, same language, without differences. They can understand. And because the area is small, they can reach out to everybody within a very short period of time. Mm-hmm. Whereas in the hills, we are small, divided into small, small tribal groups, and we have our own isms in that. We are divided over so many things. Mm-hmm. Each hillock, each range has got a different community, a different dialect, and we hardly find any commonness in amongst ourselves. So that is why to reach out to our tribals, it's a Herculean task, even for our civil societies also. It is hard. And yet, in spite of the difficulties we are faced with, I think our tribals should do the extra mile and then try to motivate or try to make aware our people as to how our rights are going to be impinged or how our privileges are going to be impinged. So that is there. Our people only have to understand. We have to work hard. We have to understand the issues, make our common people also know where, you know, if some things like that happen, where we will be hurt or where we will gain and how, you know, our rights will be snatched off or whatever. No? Mm-hmm. So I think this has to be understood. So I do not like to say that you must do more.
right. Yeah, thank you so much. Just one last question on the elections related to, I mean, topic related to the election, especially of the ADC. Since the ADC has not been conducted for so many years, like we have mentioned earlier about the Indonaga Peace Talk, the public has also wants this election to be done as soon as possible because it is important for us. Like you have mentioned earlier, it is necessary for our livelihood as well, for us to develop as well. But then the Manipur government seems to be not taking much interest in conducting the ADC election. What would be your opinion on this? And then not conducting the election, does it breach any kind of constitution provisions given to the tribals? And what would be your opinion on the government? I mean, your suggestion or your advice on the government on how to go about? Because even the bill, there are lots of bill pending, which were tabled on the in the assembly, and then in the last election, I mean, the last assembly, and the HAC recommended ADC Bill 2021, which was proposed by the HAC, was not even tabled on the assembly election. So this ADC election seems to be a very contentious issue as well. Do you think, like we discussed, this is somehow related, so I'm clubbing it up. The dominant community, the Meitei community, do you think, since the government is formed by the majority of the Meitei community, do you think they have an interest of not willing to conduct the election of the ADC because this is pertinent to our, you know, our development, the tribal's development? What would be your opinion?
Yeah, ADC or the panchayat elections are basically to do with, you know, empowerment, devolution of power to the grassroots.
Right.
So, fortunately for the valley dwellers, the panchayats are functioning, though their elections are also due for the last 6 months or more, and then their elections have also been delayed. They are also wanting their elections to be held quick.
Okay.
So the government of Manipur have responded that maybe during the time of April, they will conduct it. But until now, we have not seen any things going on in the on the ground. Mm. Whereas in the hills, it is for more than 2 years now, and they have said that it is not anywhere before April, and so it is after April. So whether anything's been done to make that happen in the near future is also not understood. The evolution of power to the grassroots, I think, so it's so important. Local right. bodies must be strengthened. Local bodies must act in such a way that you know, the people at the grassroots benefit in all of this. Now, the 2021 bill, that the ADC bill that was tabled and which was not put forward. Sorry. Apparently, it's also contentious. Mm. See, there are two minds, even among our own tribal people also. Mm. So, when our mind, when our desires are split, divided, then it becomes very difficult for the concerned authorities also to take any comprehensive decision. No? Mm. Now, what will happen is 2021 election, that bill, as if it were to come, I do not know. But as of now, the people think that there is no point holding the ADC election in this same prevailing conditions. Mm. They are just getting some amount of money. And if we actually look into the actual structure of the ADC, they are absolutely nothing.
Okay.
There is no power. There is nothing that they can actually do. It is the DCs or the COs who are doing everything. Mm-hmm. And so there is no real empowerment. Mm-hmm. This is what is being felt by the people.
Okay.
But however small it may be, many other on the other side, they think that we can do at least something. Now, it is up to us, the tribals, the our leaders, to actually analyze and see whether it is good. If we feel that ADC elections should be held, mm-hmm. it should be held with right powers given to, and then with right financial authorities given, and then, you know, they should be able to do some things that are actually tangible. As of now, they're there just for namesake. That is what is being felt.
Right.
And so because of this two conflict, we have to balance whether or not we'll accept it as it is, or whether we will wait for something else better to come.
Right.
So I think there needs to be a lot of debate, a lot of studies.
Do you think the central government aware of the situation, and is there anything that they can do? Because this has been going on for so long, and then the Manipur government seems to be not willing to empower the ADC. For example, there may be 28, 29 heads which has been powers and functions which has been given to the ADC, but then only four or five will be functioning. So this is why people feel that the ADC has not been empowered as they should be. So is the center aware of this issue? And then is there any way the center can intervene and then empower the ADC? Or is it just a state subject, I mean a state issue?
See, there seems to be confusion even amongst our tribal people.
Mm-hmm.
We think that the ADCs are formed as per notification of the President of India.
Mm-hmm.
Following the Article 371C. But if we read very carefully, and the agreement that was made between the government of Manipur and the government of India at that point of time, is that the 371C has been said that it will be implemented like that. However, they have included with local adjustments.
Okay.
Now, the clause that local adjustments has become contentious. Now, the government of Manipur has taken full advantage of this local adjustments, and then the tribals feel, or those in the council feel, that they have no power.
Mm-hmm.
And so these are issues that has to be dealt with. We have raised this with the authorities concerned in Delhi. They say that this is actually a state issue. See, after they have handed over, and then the state has framed its own rules and regulations, and then whatever that they can do. That is why they say that it is now a state issue. So the state government has to be convinced that the tribals or the ADCs should be empowered. So unless they are convinced, it becomes a problem.
Mm-hmm.
There should be no two opinions among the tribal people also.
Right.
Because when there are two opinions, somebody else takes advantage of that and work to divide. And so these are some of the tricky issues that remain. However, I feel that we must sit together and we must trash it out. Mm-hmm. Unless the councils are empowered, mm-hmm. unless they have given certain, they're given certain authorities, be it financial, developmental, or legislative powers, unless they're given that, it remains meaningless. Mm-hmm. They're just become an agency or the tool of the government to do what somebody else tell them to do. No? Right. So it is, these are some things that need to be trashed out.
Right. Looking at our discussion, I feel that the unity of the tribals, the unity of the Nagas, unity has become one of the main thing which we should be focused on. All right, I have asked the major questions which I have framed for you. But lastly, but not the least, the general election of Lok Sabha will be in 2024. You're in your tenure, you have more than a year or so. So is there any unfinished task which is in your pocket, which you have planned in, and then beyond 2024, what are your visions for the future? And is there anything which you'd like the public to know about your future, as well as the unfinished task which is under process or which are yet to be done? Can you share it with us?
Yeah, when I first came in 2019, mm-hmm. that is in the 17th Lok Sabha, I had a lot of vision. Mm-hmm. I really thought that higher education should come up in the hill areas also. Mm-hmm. Today, excepting for the medical college that was just established during this term in Churchanpur, excepting mm-hmm. for that, there seem to be no other higher education centers. Mm-hmm. And so I have been demanding for this since 2020. Mm-hmm. So even recently also, I met up with the Prime Minister, I put in a representation. I also gave him a note he asked for on an informal note. So on that also I have given, and then we have also issued the same memorandums to the education minister, mm-hmm. and then also to the tribal minister, and also to the president of India, and things like that. So many letters have been written for the need of establishment of higher education centers in the hills of Manipur. So the government is very slow. I really do not know what is stopping them. But when okay. I met them recently, the education minister has promised that he will do it. Mm-hmm. So I'm only hoping that it will come mm-hmm. during this financial year.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
If it comes, good. Otherwise, it will remain an unfinished task. Mm-hmm. And then we have also been talking on tourism, because mm-hmm. the resources for building up employment, building up economy in the state of Manipur, particularly in the hill areas, we have our only resources, tourism. We have got agriculture. We are very unorganized in our agriculture also. We have small farmers. Land holdings are very small, so unorganized. But tourism is one area that we can actually develop. But tourism in the past, because of law and order, because of various other logistics, things were not moving. But today, I think that roads are becoming better. The government is a little more responsive. They are pouring in some more money, even in tourism, mm-hmm. either through the government's establishment or maybe through people who would like to make investments. And so more and more people are coming into Manipur. So the only thing is our people. Those of us who want to receive tourists in our land mm-hmm. must also change our attitude. We must right. be welcoming, we must be hospitable, we must try and do whatever is possible to develop all those things. Mm-hmm. In this year, we are also working on, for Ukhrul, for example, we have mm-hmm. the unique black pottery. Mm-hmm. So the unique black pottery, when I presented this to the Honorable Prime Minister, he was so impressed. He mm-hmm. asked so many questions on that. Okay. So this is unique because it is just handmade.
Right.
And this is completely with only the raw material available in that area. Mm-hmm. So we do not know whether raw materials from elsewhere can also be used. But I think this being unique, we want to develop this into an artist village. Mm-hmm. So Ukhrul will become an artist center of focus,
okay.
whereby a lot of tourism will also be coming. We're hoping that in the next few months, a lot of investments will come, mm-hmm. and this will be developed. Okay. And similarly, we have our art, people mm-hmm. who do handicrafts, maybe artists mm-hmm. who paint and things like that, and also including our own weaves. You know, a lot of art is there. Mm-hmm. So this type of things will also be incorporated along with this, and we will develop Ukhrul as a hub for artists.
That's great news.
Yeah, so this is, and then of course right. we have got our singers and, you know, people who write poems mm-hmm. and, you know, things like that. So Ukhrul has a lot of artists, so mm-hmm. we want to promote that. And of course in the hills of Manipur, elsewhere also a lot of artists are also there, mm-hmm. but we are focusing on Ukhrul right now. So if that happens, within this time is good, but we will mm-hmm. continue on because it doesn't just end there. It's right. just the beginning.
Right.
We'll have to develop it into more and more so that it becomes maybe an academy, a place of learning, even for others from across the world also. Mm-hmm. So this will also at the same time promote tourism. And then like that, we also need to develop various other aspects. Mm-hmm. Say we have our, infrastructures that need to be developed. That's why we want to establish passport seva kendras.
Okay.
I propose for Ukhrul, for Senapati, and for Tamenglong. Mm-hmm. Hopefully this will come very soon.
All right.
There are few. I think the ministry is doing some refining the whole thing. Mm. And I hope that the orders will come and then we will establish them soon.
Okay.
So. If those type of things come, our people can also be exposed to the rest
right.
of the world.
Right.
And they can travel, they can see the world, and then bring back whatever they see and learn, and then bring back to develop our own land also.
Mm-hmm.
Then again, for generation of employment, we mm-hmm. have tried to do so many things. But somehow, as I say, because we are not accessible to credit,
mm-hmm.
This is one of our setbacks. But now we are also setting up FPOs, Farmers Producers Angle
okay.
Organizations. Mm-hmm. And I think here we have already identified a few CBPOs,
mm-hmm.
meaning this will be community business development organizations. And they will come and aid the FPOs
okay.
in the villages. So we are hoping that in Ukhrul, that Chingai and Jasami block,
mm-hmm.
this particular year, that focus will come into those areas. And then in Sarapati, a few blocks, because this will be block-wise.
Okay.
And then, so in Manipur, we have about 51 blocks altogether, in Kamjong site also, Chandel site, and then Churchampur, and then Tamenglong, Noni.
Okay.
So, a few blocks are there, 51 blocks they have identified mm-hmm. to be able to establish this type of things.
Mm-hmm.
And so this, together with funds that we will also channelize through various other Indian organizations of the government
mm-hmm.
To fund these people. They can also approach for loans from the banks also. So this CBPOs will train our people mm-hmm. and then they will be able to, the farm-based producers will be, upgraded, value addition also will be done, and then those type of things will come. So
okay.
we hope that a lot of development will come in the okay. next near future.
Okay.
As you say, unfinished tasks will remain. If right now the delimitation, again, a fresh movement is going on, they have already filed a PIL, and the mm-hmm. Supreme Court has mm-hmm. already given directives to the state governments also to do it. Following those type of things, the Assam government has already decided that they'll do the delimitation in their
okay.
state.
Okay.
Now, Manipur, Nagaland, and Assam, and Arunachal, we have not taken any positive decisions.
Mm-hmm.
So the state of, we have seen the civil society's movement coming up in Arunachal.
Yeah.
Whether or not we will also have the same type of mm-hmm. mood coming into Manipur, we will mm-hmm. have to wait and see.
Okay.
So if it comes, we are only hopeful.
Do you think that is mandatory for us to get what we deserve?
See,
the people's movement.
Actually, the government should be sensitive. Mm. They should just do it before there is
right.
war.
No? Right.
There is a
prevention
demand.
Is better
yeah,
than cure.
Yeah, it should be there.
Right.
When I was a student, I used to say, as Sir, the government seems not responding to anything else other than buns and blockade. So that is why we're forced to do this.
Right.
When I said like that, that's ibuwan nang suhen maleda. So, you know, that is something like that.
Right.
So I think the government should not continue to be like that.
Right.
We should be sensitive and understand the need of the people. So
correct.
We hope it will be good.
And those points which you mentioned earlier, are those planned to be achieved in this tenure, or are those one in your vision for the future, which you mentioned earlier?
These are some of the things I've already initiated.
All right. And so it's under process.
Yeah, it's under process. Mm-hmm. I'm only hopeful that before the end of the tenure, many of this will come.
All right.
And then, of course, some of them will spill over. We have so much of road networking yet to be done.
Okay.
And then so much of other, you know, institutions that needs to be developed. So much of, you know, what do you call, investment areas that needs to be done.
Okay.
I have been working on a number of things. We have already identified a few places,
mm-hmm.
and we're only hopeful that these investors will come. This April is one area where mm-hmm. investors meet will be conducted. Yeah, this G20 was another one, but specific for this state of Manipur, we are in, we are organizing one investors meet.
Okay.
So before that summit comes, we have already been talking to this potential investors.
All right.
So not blindly, we identify what may be possible, and so we are also bringing. So our people need to be also giving, meaning they expect so much from the government, land issues, light, power, then licensing. You know, when there are roadblocks, it becomes a hindrance.
Okay.
So we should be open.
Right.
So once those type of things come, I'm sure opportunities are plenty.
Mm-hmm.
And because this is being opened up to Southeast Asia, I think people look at Manipur as a possible destination.
Right.
So we must only help the people to come and invest.
Okay.
And then we must be conducive so that we also share the development of India.
Are there any few things which you'd like to mention on your vision beyond 2024? Some major things in your vision beyond beyond this tenure?
See, I wish to make Manipur, or particularly the hill areas, a Switzerland, a place where people will find pleasure.
Mm-hmm.
We look at the hills and say, we cannot do anything like that. We cannot just resign to that.
Okay.
This, when the hills are rockier, when it is more difficult, this will bring more excitement to people who are looking for it.
The hills has the potential.
Yeah, the hills have so much of potential.
All right.
The only thing is we must preserve our forest.
Okay.
Once we preserve our forest, it will bring everything possible in the world. Now, few decades from now, there will be no more water.
Mm.
Water will become a scarce commodity.
Right.
And then now petrol, diesel, because of climate change, they are also trying to ban, and then slowly it will be taken over by green energy.
Mm.
So when things like that come, I think we must be prepared for such type of changes. All of us are now buying vehicles after vehicles, and especially condemned in cities, we are bringing them to our own land, I think we are spoiling. So let us preserve our environment, let us make ourselves conducive to receive any form of development that comes. But at the same time, we also need to learn. We need to change our attitude. We need to, you know, be more open to receiving newer ideas, innovations. And so I encourage the young people to skill yourself better, to be, you know, to be more serious in our attempt to studies and you know, things like that, so that we can do better.
Right.
Sports is one area which we can really do. So let us give our energy all for the future.
Great. Yes, those are the questions which I've prepared for you. So just as a concluding remark, as the final message, especially to the youth, what kind of message would you like to give it to our, the people of Manipur in general, or the tribal people in general, but particularly to the youths, because youths are the future. Youths are the pillar of the nation, the future. So I would like you to focus on the youth and send out a message as the concluding remark of our interview.
Yeah, thank you very much, Sorin. As a concluding remark, you know, we in the hills of Manipur are 90% or more Christians.
Right.
And that is why the youth are the future of our days, of our people. We need to develop our youth so much. Now, we want to be fruitful. we are ambitious, we want to achieve things. But the Bible says in John 15, mm-hmm. verse 6, you know, it says that I'm the vine, ye are the branches. Mm-hmm. And if I remain in you and you in me, you will bear much fruit. I think much fruit is what we desire. We want to be meaningful, we want to be useful, we want to be productive. Let us be a productive, useful society by remaining on the branch, on the vine. The vine is the Lord Jesus Christ. Because as Christians, unless we are absolutely linked with our Lord, our Maker, from whom we get all the resources, our knowledge, our wisdom, our love, our passion, our compassion, you know, everything, unless we draw it from Him, we cannot bear the fruit, the much fruit that the Bible talks about. So in order to be good in our studies, in order to be successful in our businesses, in order to be good in our enterprises, whatever that we take, I think it is important that we remain faithful to God Himself. Let us always abide by Him so that we will be fruitful.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Yes, and thank you so much to you too, Honorable MP. It's been an honor, it's been a pleasure hosting you, doing this exclusive interview. We have gained so much of information from you, and then sharing your opinion, your experiences. Everything has been, is going to be very fruitful, and especially to the youths. We look up to you as an inspiration, a leader for all of us. I wish you success on behalf of all the people of your constituency. I wish you success, and may God give you wisdom, and then may we thrive under your leadership. That is my wish. We will continue to pray for your leadership, and then hopefully all these visions which you have set up for our people, and then the process which you have initiated, we hope that it will be implemented and successfully implemented for the benefit of all of us. So in this few months left,
14 months,
yeah, may it be a fruitful one, and then beyond that, it's in the hands of the God. Hopefully positive things will come, and then under your leadership, more positive things will bless us, especially to the tribals, to the people of the hill. Thank you so much. May God continue to use you.
Thank you so much. Yes. We have so much to do. We must press on. We must continue on.
Yes. The final thing, I mean, the most important thing which I learned in our exclusive interview today is the unity of the people, the importance of the people, the potential of the people.
Right.
I think
right.
We need to continue to do that, and we must all come up together. It takes every one of us a collective effort for us to develop, for us to progress. So I think that is the message. For me personally, which I've learned today, and I believe our viewers will agree with the same, and that our viewers will continue to give you the support you need so that all these visions and the projects you have planned for us will be successfully implemented for all of us. Thank you so much, Doctor, once again. And thank you so much to all the viewers today. It's been an honor, it's been a pleasure talking to our Honorable MP. I believe you all felt the same, and then the appeal, the suggestion, the advice which have been made by our Honorable MP, I think we should take it to our heart. We should implement it. Each and every one of us should do it. We should stop depending on others to do what's good for us. We should do what is our responsibility. Let us take our own responsibility, and then do this together. It is not possible for one parliamentarian to do it alone, by his own. Whatever he is doing, it's good for the good of us. Let us take it to our heart and then do it together. Collective effort is what we need in these days. The most important thing, which he has mentioned, I've mentioned earlier, but let me repeat it. Unity of the people, the power of the public. Also, to preserve our forest. Three main things I'd like to reiterate that. In this interview, we were able to listen to what our Honorable MP has to say, what he has been up to, what he has for the future. So after listening to this interview, I'm sure it's going to be a very, very fruitful one for each and every one of us. It's going to be a time well spent. That is what I would like to end it. Thank you so much. We'll see you in the next episode. Please continue to give your feedback to our channel. Hopefully, through this platform, we'll be able to do much for our people. We'll be able to serve you better in every way possible. Thank you so much. Please join us in our next episode. Thank you.